You are listening to Mining Stock Education, where you'll learn from the top leaders in the natural resource sector and uncover quality mining investment opportunities.
We are in this to make a discovery. We are in this to sell this company and make money just like the rest of our shareholders do. We're going to be drilling in just a matter of days. I don't anticipate we'll stop drilling for the next 6 to 9 months. That's my plan. We spent an awful lot of work putting together this portfolio with the idea that when the time is right, we're going to raise money and put it into the ground. And the time is now. And now it's all about putting the money into the ground and looking for that billion-dollar drill hole that we seek.
Thank you for tuning in to Mining Stock Education. I'm your host, Bill Powers. And today we're going to be doing a company profile interview. And the company I introduced to you today, I wish I had actually bought back in February 2020 of this year when I was discussing with its current CEO about its value and potential. That was before Mr. Sprott, Eric Sprott, and his group invested in the company. But even with the notoriety and the share price bump that comes with Mr. Sprott's investment, I find the current risk-reward investment proposition very compelling. So I am going to be participating in the current financing that will be closing later this month. I'm talking about Orefinders Resources. The ticker is ORX in Toronto and ORFDF on the OTC. The CEO joins me today. His name is Mr. Stephen Stewart. Stephen is actually a returning guest. About 18 months ago, Stephen was on the show, not to talk about his company then, but rather to discuss attracting and retaining the next generation of mining company management, as he is a leader with the Young Mining Professionals Group that is concerned about this topic. But for today's show, he's going to be talking exclusively about Orefinders Resources and the investment proposition that it presents to the market. So with that introduction, Stephen, welcome back to the show.
Bill, pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
And I'd like you to start off by sharing a little more about your background, your group's background, and your past success. I don't think the market is aware fully of your past success, which you shared with me back in February when we were originally chatting about your company. Please share a little more about your background.
Sure, happy to. So I grew up in the mining industry. My father was a mining lawyer, and I always worked side by side with him, and I still do. He's still involved in all of our companies. So I grew up discussing and thinking about this industry at the breakfast table and the dinner table. Formally speaking, my background is in finance, so I understand how money works and how things are valued. That's really been my focus. And I apply that towards the junior mining industry, which isn't really high finance, but certainly it in dollars and cents matters. And in terms of my past successes, our group, I guess, largely is known for being the assembler of what became the Cote Lake project. And we drilled the discovery hole, and we were significant shareholders in Trelawney when it was sold back in 2012 to the IM Gold or IM Gold. For over almost $700 million. So that was one of our big wins. And we were also involved with the early days of what's now called the Ring of Fire in Northern Ontario, which is a phenomenal world-class deposit up there that sadly has fallen on hard times due to infrastructure and issues. But that was been our background. But ever since 2015, we have been involved with Orefinders and other companies which are in its portfolio.
When a new speculator or investor is looking at a potential exploration and development company, one of the things, as you know, we need to look at is the management's perspective. Can we trust them with our money? And one of the first things you look at to see is how do they compensate themselves? Share a little bit about your perspective on the whole idea of founder shares, options. How have you bought your shares? When do you plan to sell your shares?
Okay, good question. Firstly, I pay myself $10,000 a month. Very simple. In terms of founder shares, there are zero founder shares that I have received from Orefinders or actually from any of the companies I'm involved with, and I'm involved with a few. So I have bought with cash every single share that I own, vis-a-vis on market or in a private placement. And I typically participate in every single private placement I'm involved with. Not everyone, but most. So I am directly aligned with shareholders in that sense.
If someone sees you selling in the open market, what should they think?
They should sell too. You know, no, frankly, I mean, you know, unless we have a tremendous success and we are, you know, multi-dollar stock, I don't believe that anybody sitting in my seat should be selling their shares while trying to convince the public that they should be buying those very same shares. That sends the wrong message. We are in this to make a discovery. We are in this to sell this company and make money just like the rest of our shareholders do. And I'll note that, you know, I do pay myself, of course, a salary. I think I earn every penny of it. But I will also note that in the last number of years, I've put more money into this company than my salary by quite a distance, I would imagine. I own about 5 million shares in Orefinders.
So you're an investor even more so than an employee.
Well, that's the only way I'm going to make money. I mean, nobody got rich off a salary. I'm in this business to make substantial money. And I think with Orefinders, we're in a good position to do that. So, you know, $10,000 a month pays the rent, so to speak. But I'm here to make 10, 20, 50 times my money.
Stephen, when we spoke 18 months ago in that initial interview, I remember you sharing with me that your approach was to acquire assets, and at that time you weren't particularly focused on drilling because you just didn't feel like the market would reward that, and that would, at that time, it wouldn't be in the best interest of shareholders. However, when we spoke in February, your mentality and your outlook seemed to change. Can you talk to us now about what you've done in the last few years with Orefinders to set yourself up for what you're about to do right now?
Sure. Well, you're absolutely right. From 2015 to December 2019, Orefinders had a very clear philosophy, which we were very forthright with investors. And we said we refused to drill. All else equal, it just didn't provide the appropriate return on investment, which we seek, which starts at 10 times your money. And also the cost of capital was too high, meaning we had to give away 25, 30% of our company to do any drill program of significance. So our share price was too low. And if you met or exceeded expectations, it was often met with a liquidity event. Now, if you made a world-class discovery like a Hemlo or a Voisey's Bay, you know, that would have been superseded, but that's not really an investment proposition that we were interested in. But we're most interested in mitigating the risk. And so we saw the opportunity to take advantage of the market. The market was a down market, and we could buy other people's projects that they were having a hard time raising money for. And so Orefinders really developed this portfolio. We now have 6 assets. We accumulated them in a down market. And perhaps more importantly, we accumulated them largely out of distressed, or call it unique, situations. So we bought problems that we believe we can sell in a down market. And now we announce, if people go to our news release December 30th, we announce before, you know, anything, the gold market really started to move. We felt that the pivot was in place. And what I mean by that, it was time to go back to the drill bit. We feel and felt that investors are going to start to pay for quality results and discovery. And so we've developed this portfolio, we bought it cheap, and now we're cashing ourselves up. We've got $2 million in the treasury. We've got another probably $8 million in marketable securities, and we just announced a $2 million financing that's closing in a few weeks. That's going to give us a great position, and now it's all about putting the money into the ground and looking for that billion-dollar drill hole that we seek.
Great, and I want to talk about the fundamental value in your company. So if I do just some quick back-of-the-napkin math, your market cap as we speak is about $20 million, and your enterprise value would be about $10 million. Is that correct?
That's fair to say. With our cash, and if you strip out our cash and marketable securities, yes.
Okay, so with a $10 million enterprise value, let's first talk about your projects, your 3 projects, Knight, McGarry, and Murado. Where's the value currently before you begin to drill these projects?
Well, I guess you could say the value is retained in the ounces in the ground, and not all ounces are created equal, as we should know. However, each of those projects has either 43-101 or historical ounces in the neighborhood collectively of about a million. And you can attribute all sorts of different multiples on a per ounce basis if you're going to attribute $1 million relative, or 1 million ounces relative to our market cap, that's at, you know, $10 an ounce, which is extremely low. So I think our enterprise value is quite attractive at this point in time.
Then you also have 3 equity stakes in companies. Talk to us about this, please.
That's correct. We own three positions, I would say control block positions, one in Mustango River Resources, which we acquired vis-a-vis a hostile proxy battle that ended last year. And we've got a very exciting project in Kirkland Lake that we're going to be drilling extensively very soon. It's right beside all of Orefinders' assets as well. So that's why we got attracted to that project. As well, we have about an 8% position in a company called PowerOre, P-O-R-E, on the Toronto Venture Exchange. It owns a very sexy copper gold, very large scale mine that was operated by Falconbridge. They took out 1.5 billion pounds of copper, 1 million ounces of gold out of that. And we spun that off in 2018 because we had a non-core asset that we weren't getting any value for. It was not a gold asset, and then went on to create that company. And then last, we've got a 26% interest in a company called Pacific Precious. Pacific Precious is a private company, and its planned IPO is later this year in Q4. It's led by a gentleman by the name of Ron Stewart. Ron is not related. We just happen to be from the same clan in Scotland, if you go back far enough, I suppose. But that focus is going to be in Nevada. It controls a project right beside Barrick's Gold Rush, which is a monster deposit. And I think investors can anticipate that company to grow in terms of its portfolio in Nevada as well.
Okay, so you're raising $2 million. You'll have about $4 million in the treasury. How are you going to spend that to advance these projects?
We're going to put as much of that into the ground as possible, as I said before. And as we said in December, we believe the time is now to put it into the ground and make a discovery. The accumulation of these assets was phase one. Now phase two is to drill. And so a couple weeks ago, we put out a news release that we're going to be drilling our Night project, which is just about 60 kilometers west of Kirkland Lake. We've got 5,000 meters planned. I think investors can expect us to probably double that when we close this financing. So that'll be a first drill program. It's got a very attractive discovery drill target on it. We're going to put about 10% of those meters into a discovery target. It's sort of binary. If we hit it, it's going to be very interesting, potentially game-changing. If we miss it, it's no big deal. The vast majority of those meters are going to go towards our Tyranite project, which is an existing high-grade mine, more traditional style. It's got very good historical intersects. Now we're going deeper and we're going laterally. So we're going to be expanding those resources. So that's our first drill program on the Night. Then we'll subsequently pull the drill over to our McGarry project, which is about 20 kilometers west of Kirkland Lake. And it's beside the Kerr Addison, which was a world-class 12 million ounce high-grade producer. We have the same style of mineralization on there. Again, we'll have a sort of a two-pronged drill program approach. One is some, call it lower-hanging fruit, unknown mineralization, which is right beside the Kerr Addison. We'll look to expand our existing resource there, which we have an 8 gram per ton resource there. But also there's, on the McGarry, there's about a kilometer and a half of strike length on the Cadillac break, which is a world-class fault where all this gold in Kirkland Lake came from. It's really never been drilled. And so that's going to be the discovery aspect, and investors can expect us to come out with probably a 7,000 or 8,000 meter drill program towards the end of this year on that one as well. So details to come forth on the McGarry. And our last project's called Mirado. We've got about 450,000 ounces in an open pit there. We view that as having multi-million ounce potential, but it's really just a function of drilling it out without getting too technical in it. It's just step out drilling, but there's definitely potential to grow that. And all these assets, I'll note that, you know, our McGarry, our Knight, and our Mirado, and of course the assets that are also, we have direct exposure to in Mustango, are all very proximal. They're all, you know, next door neighbors. And that was by design, certainly not by accident. I do believe that, and I've been vocal about this, that M&A is inevitable in this industry, and Orefinders and Mustango and all of our properties have really put ourselves in front of what we see as a coming wave of M&A. Not that we're waiting on being bought out, far from it. We're going to go and, you know, drill our own properties and see what happens. But, you know, we plan to make ourselves so attractive that the big guys, the guys that build mines and operate mines, just can't resist.
Steve, speculators that focus on Canadian mining stocks will understand the significance geologically and location of your projects and why it's so good. But perhaps those that don't pay as much attention to Canada, or maybe they're newer to investing and speculating in mining stocks, you mentioned Kirkland Lake. Can you elaborate a little more on the grade and the resource at Kirkland Lake and why where your projects are located is just so excellent?
Sure. Well, Kirkland Lake can be defined as the third largest gold ore body in the history of the world. Not many people know that, but Kirkland Lake or Kirkland Lake Gold, the corporation, now mines the highest grade mine in the world. It's called Macassa. And the Macassa next year is going to be pulling out 400,000 ounces at nearly 20 grams per ton, which is just phenomenal. And they've just made a new discovery there called the South Mine Complex, which they think is going to be putting that mine in operation for the next 30, 40 years. I mean, so who said mining is not sustainable? And so that is, I guess, the big dog in Kirkland Lake town is the Kirkland Lake mine. Now, just about 20 kilometers to the east of that is something called the Kirkland. I mentioned that before. We're right beside that on the McGarry. That mine was also in its day world class. And these two mines really are the goalposts of the Cadillac break on the Ontario side, which is by no exaggeration, is a world-class fault system, which is just a crack in the earth where these hydrothermal fluids carrying the gold can seep into and deposit these gold over millions of years. There is another ore body lurking in between those two world-class monsters, and we are the third largest landowner collectively in that region between those two projects, aside from Kirkland Lake Gold themselves, multi-billion dollar company, as well as Agnico Eagle, the other major in the area. So those are the two big dogs, and then it's us. So we think we are phenomenally well positioned.
I also think it's unique that at your McGarry project, you own a tailings facility right next to the Kirkland. So as I was going through your presentation, the word that came to mind was ransom. It's almost like you have a ransom on that project, don't you?
Well, I don't know if I'd use that word, but certainly strategic would be the word that would come to mind. The Kirkland itself right now, as I said, it's shut down. It's high-grade underground mine in 96, but it has been reinterpreted into a open pit type of deposit, and that's going to get it's a big deposit too. So that's going to get a lot of attention. And as you know, I own the tailings facility, or I should say, Orefinders owns the tailings facility on its McGarry project. That is not an insignificant fact. So it is my belief that whoever buys the Kirkland, and somebody is going to buy the Kirkland, somebody large, I think, they are going to require our property, because they need to put that waste material somewhere. Now, again, that's not our strategy, but that's a nice card to have in our back pocket. However, the McGarry, I think, offers the potential to discover its own Kirkland 2.0 on it. And that's ultimately why we're there. We're not there to be in a blocking position. We're there to discover an ore body and sell it to the highest bidder. But if having the tailings facility is a plus, well, then we have that plus.
What about Mustango, one of your equity positions? You know, Eric Sprott invested in this company as well. Talk to us about the prospectivity that the Orefinder investors would get through the stake in Mustango.
Sure. Well, Orefinders owns 20% of Mustango, and you're right, Mr. Sprott came in. Actually, he came in on four separate occasions this year, two times into Orefinders and two times into Mustango. And Mustango has $4 million in his treasury right now. It announced a $3 million financing. Contemporaneous, it announced the same day as the Orefinders. It's a broker deal done by Echelon, and we've got large institutional names coming in. And I certainly hope Mr. Sprott is going to come in again. We'll make that announcement at close. And it is going to be drilling. It is in the process of defining a very substantial drill program on its Ebby Baldwin project, which is directly beside the Macassa mine, which I told you about, that 400,000 ounce, 20 gram deposit that Kirkland Lake Gold owns. The Ebby Baldwin, owned by Macassa 100%, is right there. We believe it's in the same geologic setting, and it's well financed to go and find a discovery on its own. If it hits, I think, you know, all, I don't say all, it's not simplistic, but what Mustango is seeking is a couple of intersections to prove that Kirkland Lake ore body, which I mentioned, which has been mined for nearly 100 years and is the third largest gold ore body in the world. We are trying to prove that it continues to go west onto our property. And when I say continue, I mean the Macassa is one of seven mines in history which have extracted from this ore body. We believe that Mustango has the eighth. And we've got, we will come closing this financing, have $7 million worth of drilling to go out there and prove it. If we do, then oh boy, is that 20% that Orefinders owns going to be worth an awful lot.
Excellent. And Pacific Precious, if you could give us your commentary on the speculative upside before we conclude.
Sure. Well, that is a, what's going to happen there is Orefinders owns 10 million shares. It's going to dividend out at least 5 million of those directly to our shareholders as a part of the IPO process. So Orefinder shareholders can expect a zero cost based dividend coming to them and then and by the end of the year. It owns a project called the Golden Trend, which is again contiguous, like we, I guess we like contiguous projects, but this this project is contiguous to the Gold Rush, which is a nearly a 15 million ounce, 10 grand per ton monster deposit owned by Nevada Gold Mines, which is the JV between Barrick and Gold Rush. This is a monster mine. We believe we are in the same geological context. This is in the Cortez Trend. It is really, you know, the 90, you know, Beverly Hills 90210 zip code to be in gold gold mining area. So that is a very prospective project that Pacific Precious is going to raise money for in the very near term and put some holes in there and trying to find a deposit. Addition to that, you can expect the leadership led by Ron Stewart to go out and acquire additional projects. We love Nevada. Well, we love, first of all, I love Ontario. I love Quebec. There's no better place to do business. If we're going to do business anywhere else, it would be in Nevada. And so that's giving us and Orefinder shareholders direct exposure to Nevada.
As I said, I think with an enterprise value of about $10 million Canadian, just with the fundamental value within the company, I find that compelling. And then Stephen, just to recap here, with your position in Pacific Precious, Mustango, and the three projects, how many projects will be drilled, let's say, within the next 6 months and potentially more value created?
I think once we close this financing, we're going to be drilling in just a matter of days. I don't anticipate we'll stop drilling for the next 6 to 9 months. That's my plan. So we're going to start drilling on the night. All right, we're probably going to double that to 10,000. We're going to have at least 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 on McGarry, and then last we're going to drill on Murado, which is, you know, certainly which our first project we had, but certainly not doesn't deserve to be mentioned last. Those three projects are going to get an awful lot of attention. As I said off the top, we spent an awful lot of work putting together this portfolio with the idea that when the time is ripe, we're going to raise money and put it into the ground, and the time is now. And so, you know, our shareholders can expect us to do exactly what we said we're going to do, and we'll see if Mother Nature cooperates.
And we get the exposure through Mustango and Pacific Precious and those drills turning as well. Well, this is what I look for in a junior mining company, an attractive valuation for my entry spot, as well as catalyst in the near term. And there's several catalysts, many drills turning, as you saw. This is why I'm coming in through this private placement. We'll also be following up and covering Orefinders as they're a new show sponsor. To learn more, go to orefinders.ca. And if you're in the States and would like to purchase on the OTC, find it under the ticker ORFDF or in Toronto under the ticker ORX. Thanks for giving us an overview today, Stephen, and I look forward to updates in the near future.
Great, Bill. Thank you very much for having me.